But Alex Del Magani, good to see you, my man. It's, I haven't spoke to you like face to face for a while now.
I know, it's funny. It's funny what this whole situation has done. It's got everyone communicating now more.
Yeah, absolutely. And obviously, everyone's in the same boat with this lockdown. But you know, from yourself, you know, an athlete, a professional athlete, how are you sort of coping mentally, physically, with the lockdown?
Well, you know what, it's hard because I'm used to obviously being active, and I'm keeping very active. In fact, I'm just training more so than ever, you know, believe it or not, because there's nothing else to do. I'm taking it like prison, you know. I'm just training more and more and more, and the more I train, the more I get to eat too. So, you know, I like my food, so I'm training a lot. But you know, obviously it's not a good situation now. I'm one of these guys that like to fight as much as possible, train constantly in the gym. I live and breathe boxing, as you know, but I can't complain because there's people dying. They've got family members dying. There's people losing their careers. You know, it's a bad situation. Really is. So I'm not gonna complain and go, I'm sat inside, I'm bored, or you know, something like that, because that's a selfish thing to do, and I'm not that. You know, it's a bad situation. What about you? How are you?
Bad situation. Yeah, I mean, you know, like you said, I mean, I'm lucky, I'm blessed. I've got a little bit of a garden out there, a bit of outside space. You know, I feel sorry for people who are stuck in high-rise flats and everything. I'm locked down with a two-year-old, so if you hear her screaming, that can be testing. Anyone with kids out there, I respect the struggle. But yeah, as you say, you know, there's people in worse situations, isn't there, Alex? So, you know, I saw some pictures of you and some videos of you outside training. So has it sort of given you an opportunity to sort of vary your training techniques and get back to like old school techniques in a sense?
Yeah, you know what? I've trained a lot at home before, you know, and boxing is a basic sport at the end of the day. There's a lot of things at home you can do if you have a punch bag. I've got everything what you have in the gym at home, so I'm blessed in that way. But boxing's for instance, Johnny Tapia, you know, Johnny Tapia, when he's beating his drug addiction. I don't know if you read the book.
I've not read the book, but I know a little bit about Johnny Tapia. Yeah,
it's a good book. But his wife Teresa locked him in the house to you know, cold turkey his drug addiction, and he was running around the room. Not saying I'm doing that, obviously, but he was running around the room, shadow boxing, doing press up setups. 3 weeks after he got out, he knocked the guy out, you know, he fought. It's all about a mentality thing. And sometimes you've got to just, you know, be kind of inventive, you know, use your imagination on what's around you, you know. But yeah, I'm training hard, and I'm looking forward to, as soon as the fights come on, wherever it is, if it's America, England, wherever, I'd like big fights, you know, and be as busy as possible.
Do you think this period, then, this lockdown period, might separate the true professionals from the fighters that perhaps might get, you know, be out in the sun having a few drinks and whatever instead, and you know, indulging a bit? You know what I mean? Like, do you think it might have a separating factor?
Yeah, I think. Do you know what? I think this is gonna cause a lot of changes in boxing. It's gonna be very difficult for the ticket sellers, obviously, because. You know, it's very uncertain times that we live in. Like, everyone's got their theory of what's going to happen. But I definitely don't see people rushing into crowded events anytime soon. I think I read something online, something like the fall of next year.
That really? Right. Events,
yeah, I don't know if it'll take that long. But I think it all all banks on the vaccine.
Yeah.
When the vaccine is brought in, or when there's a cure, that's when, you know, crowd events will start coming in. But they, like Bill Gates, I think, said it was 18 months away. And that's, I don't know, I think that's about right, you know, because they've got to test it. They've got to see if there's any side effects. I think, but then you hear on the other side of the story, there's some promoters doing their show to July. I think that's way too ambitious.
There's talk of this sort of behind closed doors sort of mechanism. Yeah, I mean, would you be open to fighting behind closed doors?
100%. I'd fight in anyone's living room if I just want to fight and get that money and get that win, you know. So yeah, crowd, no crowd, doesn't matter to me. boxing and fighting is my job, you know. Like I say, luckily, you know, I've got a great manager, Mick Hennessy, behind me, and you know, he's done great things for me already and continues to do good things. And if we have to go to behind closed doors, then, you know, I'm down for that, no problem. And I think that's what's gonna you know, first start off with. It's going to be behind closed doors or very, very limited crowd capacity.
Yeah. It might be strange, though, because we're known in this country and in the UK and Ireland for having these buzzing atmospheres. And also, you've been over in Mexico training throughout a big portion of your life. Bang, buzzing crowds, man.
England rivals Mexico. I don't know. Mexico just is crazy.
Well, you know, it's an interesting. You mentioned Mick there, and Mick, I've always had a lot of time for Mick because he's a stand up guy, and you know, he did reschedule that fight. I was there with the first time he meant to fight Fonseca in Bolton, and that was a mad night. I've never seen something like that happen with someone pulling out so close to the fight. I wasn't sure it was going to happen again, but you know, you did what you had to do, all teams, and you got the rematch on, and that was one of the fights of the year, that rematch. You know, I had a look at it again this morning because I knew I was going to be talking to you, and the pace was ridiculous.
Yeah, it was a hot pace.
I feel like you sort of, I know how good you can box. I've seen you, I used to see you training with Arnie in Manchester and all that. You know, I know, it looked to me like you just wanted to make it Mexican style and have a fight as well.
Yeah, it was a bit personal. There's a lot of things going on. Also, I was a bit pissed off. You know, obviously the fight being postponed the first time. And we said some things, and I felt like I can fight him and beat him at his own game, which in my opinion I did, and lots of other people's opinion. You know, a lot of his shots were hitting me on the shoulders and arms, and the headbutt blurred my vision a bit. It wasn't really the cut, it was more the collision. But I felt that I won that quite, you know, by a few rounds. So it was a good fight, and it was a good
great fight.
Yeah, it was just, I'm looking forward to my next fight. You know, I just want to fight.
Will your scheduled fight with Zani still take place? I mean, that makes sense, that fight. The European title's on the line. It's an eliminator for world honours as well. So it makes sense, the fight. And it's a good fight for you, actually, looking at him. I had a little look at him today. It's a good fight for you, that.
Yeah, I expect that to just, you know, be postponed and rescheduled.
Yeah. But you know, you also mentioned
exciting. I think that's going to be an exciting fight as well, because he's you know, a tough pusher, comes to fight, got heart. Technically, he's not even on my level in my league.
He's very durable, though, isn't he? Yeah, he's proven that.
Very good chin. Very good. He's got a very good record. What, 31-3?
Only the three losses, and two of them went to the same guy. One was to Commie, and that was a good fight, the Commie fight as well. Yeah, so he's definitely a decent operator.
I haven't seen that, but I heard that he deserved to beat Commie.
It was a very close fight.
But styles make fights. We'll see how he does against me.
There you go. Well, I've noticed something about you, Alex. You know, when I first met you a few years ago in Manchester, you were a lot, you're a bit more chilled in terms of like the way you come across on camera. We did a first interview sat in the table tennis table. Yeah, let's not talk about the table tennis.
No, we've got to get this on camera. I see you talking that big talk on that table tennis champ. I'm the table tennis champ. I'm the ping pong champ.
There's only two people that are beating me at table tennis, you and Carl Frampton. They're the only two people that have beat me at table tennis. That is true.
Do you want Lucas told me that he beat you?
Lucas didn't beat you. Well, not that I can remember. Well, let's move on from that. You've changed. I see. You know, I listen to you a lot. You know, obviously, I keep in touch with what you're doing in your career, and obviously, I've interviewed you a few times since then. You seem to have changed. You're a bit more game face. You're a bit more, you know, edgy when you talk about other fighters now. Would you say that's fair statement?
No, I think, do you know what? I think I've always been edgy. I'm just getting hungrier. You know, I'm one of these people, if I get money, I want more money. If I get wins, intention, I want more of it. I'm addicted to just I live for this sport, you know. I love it, and it always was the case. But I think now that I've got this deal with Mick, now I've got Mick, you know, with Mick and Channel 5 and these things, I'm just buzzing. I'm happy. I'm much happier now than I was when I first got interviewed by you.
Yeah.
And also, it was a different stage of my life, you know. It was I'm more comfortable in front of the camera now, whereas before I was a bit timid and, you know, it was new to me, you know. Even though I have had it like hard, you know. I've had, you know, been in Mexico fighting there, Canada there, you know. Now I'm back home in England with my family, fighting here, training here. It's lovely.
Yeah. Are you in Kent at the minute? Where
yeah,
at the minute?
I'm near Kent, near London, in between Surrey.
Yeah, okay, man. Yeah. So you're down south, you got you know, obviously you mix base down there, and you've got that. I love the Channel 5 platform, you know, being able to switch the TV on, it's free. There's been some good shows on there, and I like that platform, and I hope long may it continue. And you know, things to pass the time whilst you're sort of in lockdown. I know what you're like. I know you're thinking boxing every second of the day. So what sort of fights are you watching? Are you going back on YouTube and looking at fights?
Well, I think as far as advice to fighters, study other fighters, you know, or study fights on YouTube. You know, it's a great thing, you know. You can watch any fight you want, but nah, I read, I communicate with, you know, people. I've got friends from all sides of the globe, you know, Mexico, Canada. So obviously time difference comes about. So, you know, I'm training about 3-4 hours a day. And, you know, I'm keeping occupied, keeping busy. I'm a productive person. So I can't, if I'm going to sit around all day, I'm going to do something.
Yeah. You're not resting on your laurels. You're keeping active, and I think that's a good bit of advice for everyone. Yeah.
But you know what, the one of the things I've learned in life is, you know, you've got to be positive and turn negative situations into positive ones, and you've got to remain mentally strong, and you've got to also be grateful, you know, because at the end of the day, it's easy to be like, oh damn, you know, I want to be fighting, you know, because I live it. This is not just my passion, it's my career. But I can't complain, because my health's good, my family's health's good, more importantly. And, you know, that's better off than a lot of people right now. A lot of people right now are in chaos. And not even the people that are... What people are forgetting, people are not just dying from this disease. You know, they're dying from the effects of this disease. You know, stress, losing their job, or... they've got another disease and they're getting less medical attention, you know.
Yeah. There's a lot of collateral damage. Yeah.
Exactly that. A lot of collateral damage. And, you know, it's just, I mean, what the figures today are like 13,000 around that.
Yeah.
And then that's not even including care homes or any of that. And then if you think about all the other illnesses that have had less medical attention, it's sad. So you can't, you know, when you read about certain people, like sometimes go on this social media and that people are bored or people are depressed and things like that. And I get that everyone is, no one likes to be inside, but they've got to be grateful that things could get worse. You know, they're a lot worse off.
Sorry, it just went off there, the signal there. But I think I was just saying, I think your outlook on this situation is really good. And I think, you know, it's good to see you're in a good place there. I was going to ask you a question, actually. I've asked a few boxers this. Like, say you've got the average Joe like myself, who's not super fit or anything. What sort of training could I be doing to keep myself fit? Like, you know, if I've got a limited space, for example.
And what have you got? What have you got? Have you got skipping?
So let's just say I've got a small garden, but let's just say someone wants to go to the park. You know, what's the best all body purpose exercises they could be looking at doing just to keep fit?
Press ups, burpees, sit ups, doing those like calisthenics. You can shadow box. You can get some elastic bands and do some resistant band work. You can jump rope. You can run. You know, there's stairs. I guess you can use them.
Yeah. So you'd have to spend money. Yeah, you can train wherever, really, can't you?
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. There's a guy on YouTube. I think he's Katie Taylor's trainer, Ross.
Right.
Ross Emmett.
Yeah, that's right.
And he wrote a book called Never Gymless, and he wrote exactly like bare things around you. You can use to keep get in shape. So.
Well, I like that. I'm gonna check that out because I need some.
Them book sales should go sky high.
Well, fair enough. And there's also a couple of things I wanted to ask you about going forward. You know, I listened to your interview with the Boxing Voice. That was a good, nice little interview. That, and you mentioned, I don't know if you were joking, you mentioned that you could even go up to lightweight as well. I mean, I know you're comfortable at super feather, but. And feather, but would you be willing to go up to lightweight as well?
I would be willing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Featherweight to lightweight. I'd turn it up. Henry Armstrong strung up in this.
But he had four weight classes, so you need to go up an extra one as well.
Yeah, and back in the day as well.
Yeah, man.
Back in the day, there was no super or junior divisions.
Yeah. He was my favorite fighter of all time, to be honest with you, Henry Armstrong.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know you love your old boxing. Who was your favorite super featherweight of all time?
Super featherweight isn't an old weight division, is it?
No.
You know, it's either featherweight or lightweight, but super featherweight, Chico Corrales.
Okay, that's an interesting choice. There's definitely some of your Mexican flavors coming out there.
Aguello. Yeah, Aguello's a man. Aguello's a great, great fighter. But I was thinking about one fight that I'd love and hate at the same time to watch is because it's Arturo Gatti's birthday today, isn't it? Gatti versus Diego Corrales. What a fight that would be.
Oh yeah. That would have been a class fight.
But I wouldn't have dynamics going on there. Both guys.
Yeah. There's so many dynamics going on there. The height difference is one, and there's so many other things, but I think that would be an absolute banger.
Definitely. You know, fact, war. But they're both warriors. But yeah, I love both of those fighters. So
yeah.
I wouldn't have liked to see it. At the same time, would have loved it.
Bittersweet. I just want to switch tack just a little bit, just to the big boys now, actually, because there's a fight I wanted to ask you about. It's one that I'm actually looking forward to, which hopefully when everything gets back to normal is coming up. It's there's a few good ones, but this one in particular I like because it's so many unknowns, and it's Joe Joyce versus Daniel Dubois. I don't know if you're...
Yeah,
I think it's a fun fight, man. No. I'm looking forward to it.
You know what? Joe Joyce is heavy underdog, apparently.
Yeah, he is.
Yeah, I don't... You know, Daniel Dubois is a very good fighter, but it's one of those fights that I win it either way I see, but I definitely don't see that going to the points. I think it's...
No, definitely not.
yeah, I mean, that's a guarantee. But I think... apparently, Joe Joyce has got very good chin, and he's got very good fitness. I haven't seen too much of
His shot output's really good. He's got great. Yeah, it's going to get tested. It's going to get tested.
Who are you picking?
I pick Dubois. I think there's about 10 years age difference, and I like Joe Joyce, but I think he might just be a little bit flat footed, and if he gets caught. Dubois actually puts them together quite well. Yeah, but I do like him, man. I love his style. He wants to fight. He's like a Mexican-style heavyweight. I like the guy.
Yeah, I haven't seen much of him, but yeah, he's what I have seen. He's very, hits very hard, and yeah, I mean, they both do. So yeah, it's a pick. That's the thing about heavyweight divisions. I don't really like picking too much who's going to win because it only takes one shot, you know?
Mm. Yeah, man. Yeah, definitely. Well, you know, it's been really nice to sort of talk about a few of these things with you. And, you know, just the way you speak and the way you're coming across, it seems like you're taking this all in your stride, the whole situation. You're taking it all in your stride, and you'll just be ready for when game time happens. You'll be ready.
You know that. You know me well enough, Aki. I'm always ready. I'm always ready. But you know what? In these situations, you've got to try and just be positive, because there's being negative or being depressed or whatever, it doesn't make things better. You know, and one thing as well, everyone is going through this, and so many people are going through a worse situation. So you just got to you just got to remain optimistic that this will pass.
Yeah,
and it will pass. It will eventually pass. You just got to stay safe and remain, you know, blessed and positive that your family and you, everyone's okay. That's the main thing, because health is the most important thing.
I couldn't have put it better, man. I'm going to touch wood as well to that. I think I might have to quit while I'm ahead, because I can keep seeing this flickering off and on. But I think we've got a good 20 minutes in there, man. But you know what? This is just going to be one of the many interviews that we're going to do. There'll be so many more to come.
Man, for sure.
And I'm watching your career with great interest. I love the way you fight, man. I love the style. And there's some big fights out there for you when you move to that next level. And we'll definitely speak again. When things get back to normal, man.
For sure.
Appreciate your time.
We've got to do a little cold video with your man Tommy Dix. I want to test my boxing knowledge.
Okay. Right. Now you're taking it. Okay. All right. Okay. You versus Tommy Dix. I can make it happen.
Yeah.
We should do it.
make sure you set the right questions and don't tell him the answers.
Yeah, but even just watching you guys talk, because I know you can go back into the history of boxing, man. I thought I knew boxing until I met you, you know, and the same thing for Tommy Dick. So you two together talking the old stuff, man. Let's record that. Let's get that done.
Okay, man. Okay, it's a deal.
Yeah, man. All right. Well, it's great to see you. Thanks for your time. And I'll catch you on the other side, man. Nice one. Man.
Take care.
Take care, my man. See you in a bit.